Star Wars Episode 9, The Rise of Skywalker, was my most anticipated movie of 2019, and there was a lot of feelings, excitement, nerves, and a slew of hopes and expectations on my end going into this movie. And now that I've seen it, it's time for the moment of truth, and don't worry, this is my non-spoiler review. So here we go. I've been sitting with my feelings for about 36 hours since seeing the movie, and my brain is still in a whirlwind of thought. But right here and now, I have no shame in declaring that I really enjoyed this movie, and there are moments I loved so much. There are definitely flaws and several narrative issues that I can understand why some people think more negatively about this movie. So let's unpack my viewpoints, and again, no spoilers. I'll start off by talking about the biggest issues first and sort of where the film struggled the most, and then we'll end with the positives and the reasons why I ultimately enjoyed this movie. To me, the biggest glaring issues with this film is that it feels like it's two films jam-packed into one. It feels like this was the intended storyline for this entire sequel trilogy with little to no regard to the events in The Last Jedi, and it's very frustrating to me that Kathleen Kennedy, as the creative lead over these films, did not have a stronger handle on this trilogy and the through-line narrative to carry us through all three of them. This ninth film feels like the sequel and threequel to The Force Awakens, and with how much they don't even touch upon The Last Jedi, I'm just baffled as to why and how Kathleen Kennedy and team allowed for The Last Jedi to even be made the way that it was and waste our goddamn time if they're ultimately so quick to retcon and move the story back to what The Force Awakens started, but now with only having one film to correct and give us a finale to a nine-film saga. And let's play devil's advocate and say that they did have a through-line narrative, and that they did plan out all three films in advance, and that they did plan for all three to connect seamlessly, and that the plot elements introduced in The Rise of Skywalker was in fact planned from the beginning. Okay, then why did they allow The Last Jedi to deter so drastically, and in my opinion, so offensively from what they set up in The Force Awakens, only to bring us back to what The Force Awakens set up with no regard to The Last Jedi? It's clear that these movies are at odds with each other, and it's clear that the through-line narrative was fucked up in The Last Jedi. So that's why my greatest complaint is that Kathleen Kennedy either allowed the deterrence to happen in the first place and screw up the continuity, or they didn't truly have an actual through-line plan at all. And so The Rise of Skywalker is a complicated and mentally frustrating movie to analyze because there is so much plot and there are so many things that happen in this movie that it needed two films to flesh out in a way that I'm sure most viewers would have appreciated that much more, and I can guarantee wouldn't have pissed off nearly as many people. Because by jamming so many things, and like I said, what felt like two movies worth of story into one movie that's only 2 hours and 20 minutes, you get a movie with sloppy pacing, underdeveloped characters, characters that get little to no love at all, plot points declared with little to no breathing room, and narrative happenings that feel rushed or unearned. And for a final chapter in such a huge saga, you don't want to fumble across the finish line. Now, I'm going to list out some characters that were negatively impacted the most by this movie, but I want to be clear that I'm only going to reference characters that have been actively present in the marketing campaign and trailers for this movie, because there are many surprises in this film, and I won't go into any spoilers, and I'll only talk about the characters who have been actively showcased in all previews. And so, the characters that I feel were heavily shortchanged the most in this movie are the Knights of Ren, Janna, Rose, General Hux, Dominic Monaghan's new character, and then Zori Bliss, played by Keri Russell. Now, all of these characters were victims of rushed plots and didn't leave any strong impression on me. And some left no impression on me because they might as well have been an extra in the movie. My favorite of the new characters I listed just now is actually Zori Bliss, played by Kerry Russell. I really liked what Kerry Russell brought to this role, and it was very frustrating how little she got to do. And I can only imagine what they could have done with her had they introduced her in an earlier film. It's a shame. And I'm sorry, but the Knights of Ren are nothing to write home about, and that's all I'm gonna say about them. Now, with all that being said, I sort of fleshed out my greatest qualms with the film, and we're going to shift direction and talk about the positives. But first, I want to address how they used Carrie Fisher as Leia in this movie. Because to me, it's a mixture of negative and positive that I feel is an appropriate segue. And again, no spoilers. I firmly believe that J.J. Abrams and team were put in a lose-lose situation after the tragic passing of Carrie Fisher. There's no way you can recast this role, and digitally recreating her in the movie would have felt unnatural and just strange. But you also don't want to simply write her out of the movie off-screen altogether, because that's a dishonor to such a beloved character. So I personally think they did the absolute best with what they had. The unused footage of her that they used in this movie gave me all the feels when I saw her, even though it did feel roughly cut together with the other characters and didn't feel seamless. It was a little choppy, but I have to give them credit for trying to pull it off because I don't think anyone could have pulled it off 100%. So yes, the execution isn't perfect at all, but Leia's overall presence in the narrative and her legacy as this beloved character is presented so beautifully in this film in a way that surprised me and satisfied me. The journey was rough, but the payoff was worth it in the end. And so let's talk about some more payoffs and the things that I loved about this movie without spoilers. And first and foremost is Rey, played by Daisy Ridley, right at the center of it all. This movie brings her arc full circle from Force Awakens, and she is undoubtedly the best part about this movie. Her character is handled the best, her story is the most intriguing, and packs a lot of surprises, and I felt they really stuck the landing with her character, especially after some of the narrative flubs I thought they did to her and to her character in The Last Jedi. The movie fumbled quite a few times overall in Rise of Skywalker, but I feel that Rey was one of the few areas that won me over completely and is treated with the utmost care and respect. And if you're a Rey fan like me, you will love this movie just for her big payoff alone. And Daisy Ridley continues to kill it in her performance and brings so much nuance to this role and owns every minute she is on screen, even if some of the elements around her aren't quite as perfect. The Last Jedi left me frustrated with where Rey was in her journey, and The Rise of Skywalker pulled me out of that bleak hole and made my heart soar. Thank God. The next best thing is Kylo Ren, and I'm happy to report that Rey and Kylo are the beating heart of this movie, and they are handled the best over everything else. I have very little qualms with Kylo Ren, and Adam Driver continues to be a force to be reckoned with as an actor, and even though I took some minor issues with certain elements of his story in this movie, overall, he did an amazing job, and I greatly appreciated how the film wrapped up his overall story and how well executed he and Rey are as characters overall. The next best thing about this movie is Emperor Palpatine, and I can't talk about him hardly at all, but I absolutely loved every single moment he was on screen, and I feel safe in saying that this is the most menacing I've ever seen him, and I ate up every moment of it. And my only qualm is that we're just now getting him for the final film, and I would have killed to have had him return a lot earlier because of how great a villain he is and how much more he ups the stakes with his looming presence. My other favorite characters were C-3PO, BB-8, and new characters such as General Pride, Babu Freak, and the new droid named Dio. C-3PO was so entertaining and hilarious in this movie. BB-8 continues to be one of the most lovable droids ever created. And then I thought Richard E. Grant was a great new addition as General Pride that I wish would have been introduced in earlier films. And I thought Babu Freak and Dio were just fun and adorable new additions. Now, characters such as Finn, Poe, Chewie, and Lando were fine, and there were some good moments sprinkled about, but they landed more in the middle for me. I didn't love them, I didn't hate them, but they didn't leave a huge impression on me, to be honest. And again, that's mostly due to the quick pacing and constant plot points being introduced that held them back. This film is nothing but fan service. It's a lot, and sure, it means there are moments that feel unnatural, shoehorned, or unnecessary, or have no reason to exist or be there. But there's two sides of this coin, because the other half is the type of fan service that gave me chills, made me cry, shocked me, excited me, made me want to cheer, and gave me so many visually stunning moments that made me giddy as a Star Wars fan. I'm a sucker for nostalgia. I love the original trilogy, and I love the ties to them, and I love the callbacks, and I love bringing it full circle. And that's the route this movie took. It stands for what Star Wars has been all this time and doesn't go outside of the box in diverse ways that The Last Jedi did. And for many, that'll be a problem for you. And I get it. But for me, these payoff moments and things that happened that are the types of happenings we as fans love to speculate on and want to see happen actually happen. And so much of it felt right, and it reminded me of why I loved Star Wars to begin with. So when it comes to the actual story, I love the story in episode 9. I love this plot. I love the missions. I love the themes. I love where it takes us. Sure, there are a couple of holes or elements that could have been better, but I loved the overall story and would have loved to have seen it over 2 films. And so the issue is not the story, but in the execution, in the pacing of it all. But we didn't get 2 films, we just have this one. And yes, that makes it a rough and imperfect execution. But I can get past those issues because I feel the most important payoffs actually paid off for me, for the most part. The characters I loved most were treated with love, and the pros do outweigh the cons for me. And by the very end, my eyes were full of tears, my heart was pounding, and I was left thinking as the credits started rolling, that was a beautiful ending. Star Wars: The Rise of Skywalker has some issues for sure, but when it's good, it's great. And it set out to end this saga on a high note that I personally feel it achieved more than not. I still feel The Force Awakens is a stronger film overall, but I did enjoy The Rise of Skywalker much more than The Last Jedi. I was filled with so many mixed emotions by the conclusion of this movie, but in the end, the winning emotions were satisfaction and childlike happiness. And it gave me some of the most amazing Star Wars moments I've ever seen, and I can't wait to experience it again. It's been a long journey, but to me, the knees might have buckled, but the end of this saga ultimately sticks the landing. I'm going to give Star Wars: The Rise of Skywalker an A-. And that's my review for you. I'm curious to know what you think. Feel free to leave your thoughts and opinions down below. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe. And thank you all again for tuning in. Until next time, I'm Ryan Bamey, signing off. Bye, everyone.